First up tonight is a look at the worst oil spill in this nation's history. It took place on Friday when a supertanker owned by the Exxon Corporation hit a reef 25 miles off the port of Valdez. Exxon revealed that an uncertified crewman was in charge of the vessel. By today, 10 million gallons of oil covered 100 square miles of ocean. Late this afternoon, I spoke to Don Cornett, Alaska coordinator for Exxon, and asked about the cleanup. Mr. Cornett, what is happening in the cleanup today?
Well, we have about 200 people deployed and ready to deploy, but we are having some difficulty with the weather this morning. It whipped up during the night, and the last weather report I got was about 6-foot waves and freezing spray. So we're waiting for the wind to abate. It was very strong last night, I understand, did some damage to the Valdez air terminal.
Uh-huh. What methods are you trying to use?
We're using mechanical recovery around the ship and in several places in Prince William Sound where we're finding the oil. And we're also booming around areas that we want to protect. But we're also trying, as our plan prescribes, it's a government-approved plan that prescribes that in spills of this magnitude, we'll use oil spill dispersants. And we have run a very successful test on Saturday with dispersants. And we have permission to run a limited deployment this morning.
That is putting a chemical onto the oil, and that forces it into the bottom of the sea. Is that correct?
I think that's the common perception, but people tend to forget that oil is biodegradable. And the purpose of dispersant is not to make the oil sink, but it is to enhance the biodegradability. The mechanism, as I understand it, that happens when oil is spilled onto the water is that you lose a large percentage of it through evaporation. You lose a lesser percentage through solution into the water. And the remainder of the oil, if left alone, is attacked by nature, bacteria. The dispersant breaks the remaining oil into very small droplets. It enhances both the evaporation and the solution into the water, but it also makes a greater surface area for nature and the bacteria to attack.
Yeah.
When you say chemical, people get a little reaction to the word chemical, I think. But you need to keep in mind that this is a research that's been going on for 20 years. The Environmental Protection Agency and the Coast Guard and NOAA and the Department of Environmental Conservation of the state of Alaska all have to approve use of this before we use it. If they say don't use it, we don't use it. But if they say use it, it is in accordance with our plan, and we are using it when we get permission, and I think it is totally appropriate.
Uh-huh. Governor Cooper of Alaska says that he's very unhappy with the progress of your cleanup so far, that there was a contingency plan in effect that meant you were required within 5 hours of the spill to take action, but that nothing happened until 18 hours after the spill. What is your comment on that?
My experience with these instances, these events, is that it always appears like chaos for the first couple of days. But we have a very well-defined plan. We put it into action. I was awakened. The ship went aground at 12:30. I was awakened at 3:30. The plan was going into action at that point. But a spill of this magnitude requires bringing equipment from all over the world. And you do have local response capability at the pipeline terminal. They sent a tug out immediately to see how they could assist the tanker because she was aground and was leaking. Then they sent another tug out to assist that one. The third tug was to bring a barge that had equipment on it that would have allowed them to boom the ship. It's my understanding that there was maybe a 4 or 5 hour delay because that particular barge was being repaired. But I can tell you in that 5 hour period, there was not a great deal that the equipment on that barge could have done with the spill of this magnitude. It still required that we organize this major response effort, and it's still being mobilized, and we're up to 200 people, and I flew over the spill yesterday, and there's a tremendous amount of mechanical work going on, and if we can get started with this dispersant spraying, we will handle a great deal of this spill before it ever touches the shoreline of Prince William Sound.
Has Exxon yet determined how it was that an uncertified officer appeared to be in charge of the ship when she went aground?
there is an investigation going on to try to get the answers to all the questions. I don't know that there was an uncertified officer in charge. I don't have facts about that. But we will have all the answers as soon as this investigation is complete, and we are as anxious as anyone else to know the answers to those questions.
Well, Exxon officials have told the press that a man not certified, an officer, junior officer not certified to be conning the ship through that channel, was in charge when she went aground. You do not confirm that?
I do not have that information. No, I am in Anchorage, and the press conferences have been held down in Valdez, and there is a lag time between what is said down there and what we learn up here. But if he said it, I'm sure it's true.
I see. Environmentalists have been saying for years, Mr. Cornett, ever since these shipments of oil out of Valdez started, that it was inevitable there was going to be a spill like this, that such huge ships in such very tricky waters made an accident almost inevitable. What is your comment on that?
Well, I don't believe anything is inevitable. I think there is a very good reason when something like this happens. It's either a failure of equipment or it's a human failure. And we will know what the reason is, but I certainly don't consider that inevitable. And I think the record of shipping from the Valdez terminal has been excellent. And we will clean up this problem, and we will continue with an excellent record. But this is a very unfortunate incident that Exxon Corporation regrets as much as anyone, and we're giving it our full effort to try to correct it.
Well, Mr. Cornett, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, sir.
Joining us now with his assessment of the spill and its cleanup is the governor of Alaska, Steve Cooper. The governor is at public station KTOO in Juneau. Governor, thank you for joining us. How do you respond to Mr. Cornett's comments that there's always a period of chaos after a thing like this, but that it's going ahead as well as they can do?
Well, I don't think chaos is necessary, particularly in these circumstances. I think there was a fundamental miscalculation on the part of the industry here, and that was that a spill of this magnitude probably wouldn't ever happen. In the event, what happened was that the first response, which was supposed to be by the Alaska Pipeline Company, that's a consortium of oil producers here in Alaska, was late and it was inadequate. It was supposed to have acted within 5 to 6 hours after the incident took place. If that had happened, it may well have been that we could have kept the spill to some kind of manageable proportion. As it was, so much oil has escaped that anything we do is going to be detrimental.
Well, are you saying the response wasn't quick enough because the industry just never believed there would be a spill this large and therefore was not prepared for it?
Well, I don't want to be indiscreet about my comments, but based on the evidence, you'd have to say that the industry didn't really think that a spill of this magnitude would ever take place, and so they weren't very serious about preparing for the eventuality. Mm-hmm. Smaller spills within Valdez Harbor have been cleaned up pretty well. The industry's been pretty proficient about doing that, but I think that there was a myth going around here that the kind of spill that we see today probably never could happen.
Mr. Cornett called us back after we taped that interview this afternoon to say that your state government is being extremely cautious in letting them use chemical dispersants, the dispersants he discussed a moment ago. What is your position?
Well, the chemical dispersants are effective under certain circumstances. Even Exxon admits that you could probably only clean up about 20% of the area of this spill with dispersants. The problem with dispersants is that they are highly toxic to marine life. Prince William Sound is a very valuable marine ecosystem, and we don't want to make things worse by utilizing this dispersant on a haphazard basis. We want to be very selective about the way that we use these chemicals. They're dangerous.
He said that they would urge you not to err on the side of caution in this case because the effects of the dispersant would be less harmful than if the oil were allowed to come ashore.
Well, that's pretty academic at the moment because we have, in fact, authorized the use of dispersant in so-called Zone 1 situations, which is water that is away from land and water that is deep enough so that the dispersant can settle to the bottom. We haven't seen it yet. It's okay to use it, and we're waiting to see if anything's going to happen. We think that the performance is somewhat defective here.
You agree with them that the weather is too rough today to let them start?
No, actually, rough weather makes dispersants work better. It's the conventional method of collecting oil through skimmers, the use of skimmers and booms, that is affected by rough weather. We had calm weather earlier, and the mechanical collection was, to put it mildly, minimal. Now that there is rough weather, which lends itself to the use of dispersants, to my knowledge, no major effort is in place now.
Uh-huh. By mechanical means, you mean pumping oil out of the wounded tanker or out of the sea?
That's correct. I was referring to removing the oil from the surface of the ocean.
What is the damage in Prince William Sound so far, and what is the potential damage?
Well, so far we've been lucky, and that is that the oil has apparently reached the shore only in one place, in a place called Naked Island. This apparently took place last night, and we are in between seasons in terms of the salmon migrations, although there are a large number of juvenile salmon in the water which would be affected by dispersants. So we've been lucky so far, but our options are narrowing very quickly.
What would be your purpose, Governor, in asking the White House to make this a federal disaster relief, to give it federal disaster relief status? The White House said since Exxon is paying for the cleanup, it's not clear to them what you would be asking for.
Well, what the declaration of a federal emergency does is to free up money in case it's needed for the cleanup. Our major focus now is on the cleanup itself. The question as to who pays for it is pretty secondary. We'll sort that out in courtrooms for the next 10 or 15 years, I'm sure. But in the meantime, we want to be able to go ahead with every possible method to clean this area up. And to the extent that a federal declaration of emergency would help in that, then we want to have it.
How would it help?
It wouldn't mean that we could do anything physically that we are not doing now, but it may become useful if we find that we have to bring in large numbers of new people. This spill is going to last for quite a while, and we need an immediate funding source in order to pay technicians and other people who are going to be involved in the cleanup. So the availability of federal funds may well help in that respect.
Some environmentalists are saying today that this spill may end Arctic oil development by turning public and political opinion against it because of the risk. What do you have an opinion on that at the moment?
Well, it certainly isn't going to help. I'll say that. There's no tanker traffic in the Arctic, so there's no direct connection. There's no logical connection here, but there's certainly a connection in the mind of the public. It's going to make the so-called ANWR, the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, debate in Congress very difficult, I think.
Well, let's just spell that out a little bit for all of us. The oil industry wants to expand its drilling and extraction away into that area that you've just referred to, and that is the issue now before Congress. That's the issue you're referring to.
The industry and the state wants to responsibly develop the coastal plain that is up in the northeast corner of Alaska. It is within the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. There is a specific proposal to do that in the Congress today. And of course, the effort that's gone on so far to convince the Congress that the oil industry can do this in a responsible manner is going to be hurt by this spill.
Uh-huh. What is your own position on the expansion of that activity?
I think it can and should be allowed in an environmentally sensible manner. I think it's such an enormous potential in terms of the oil on the slope that it ought to be explored and developed in an environmentally responsible manner.
Tim Mahoney of the Alaska Coalition of 50 environmental groups said that this incident now forces the public to notice, but that there are thousands of small spills, and he says routine violations of the law by the industry there. Do you have a comment on that?
I don't think that there have been massive routine violations. I think there have been minor spills, which, by the way, have been treated fairly well. They've been picked up, and the State Department of Environmental Conservation, certainly in the last 2 years, has been very responsible at seeking out the causes of those leaks. But by and large, the Trans-Alaska Pipeline is a very effective way to get oil from one place to another. It's clean from an engineering standpoint, and while there have been some relatively minor incidents, I think that they're acceptable.
Okay. Well, Governor Cooper, thank you very much for joining us from Juneau.
Thank you, Robin.